to those blessings of God, and we are exhorted to give thanks. And we will be having our Thanksgiving service on Wednesday evening, Thanksgiving Eve, and you're invited to come and just celebrate with us an evening of thanksgiving and praise unto the Lord. On Thanksgiving Day, there will be no service here at Calvary Chapel. However, there will be a Thanksgiving dinner for you who do not have a family to gather with, or you have just a very small family and you feel like you'd like to just gather with a larger extended family here at the church. You're welcome to come to the Thanksgiving dinner. Begins at 1 o'clock, and they'll be serving from 1 o'clock to 4 o'clock. And I understand that everything is pretty well taken care of, except they could use a few more casseroles. If you'd like to sign up to bring a casserole, you can do so in the office so that they can sort of know exactly what we've got. The church provides for all of the turkeys, and then those that come usually just bring something with them. And so if you'd like to come, feel free to do so, even if you have nothing but your appetite to bring. Just, you know, say, well, I brought my appetite, you know, and they'll feed you. So great day on Thursday. God has been so good. God has blessed. I look back over the past year and I just marvel at the goodness and the blessings of God. And if you this Thanksgiving season are going through some difficult times financially, and you really don't have the funds for your Thanksgiving dinner to buy a turkey or a roast or ham or whatever, if you'll see Pastor Romaine after the service this morning, the church would like to provide for your Thanksgiving turkey or whatever. So see Pastor Romaine, and he'll make sure that you're taken care of this Thanksgiving. Say you want to gather with your family at home, you really don't want to come out to the church, but you don't have the money for your Thanksgiving dinner, see Pastor Romaine, and we'll see that you are taken care of, because we love you, and we understand when people are going through some hardships financially, especially at the present time. A lot of people laid off, and the economy isn't really recovered here in California as yet. So we'd like to make it a great day for you on Thanksgiving. So may the Lord bless you, give you a very rich and beautiful Thanksgiving, and we encourage you to join in the celebrations here at the church during the week. Let's turn now in our Bibles to the 27th Psalm for the scripture reading this morning. Psalm 27. I'll read the first and the odd-numbered verses, and Pastor David will lead the congregation in the reading of the even-numbered verses. Let's stand as we read God's word. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
And though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple.
For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock.
And now shall mine head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord.
Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me.
When thou saidest, seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek.
Hide not thy face far from me, put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation.
When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up.
Teach me thy way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies.
Deliver me not over unto the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty.
I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord.
Shall we pray? Father, even as the psalmist was so ready to respond to your command, when you said unto him, seek my face, and he responded, your face will I seek. May our hearts also be ready to respond when you speak to us about those issues of life. May there be a ready response in our hearts, Lord, unto you. And may we seek, O Lord, to do that which you would have us to do, to become what you would have us to become. Lord, our hearts pant after thee. We want to live in a way that would be pleasing to you. Lord, guide us in your path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We have now arrived in our Bible study at the Sermon on the Mount. And tonight we'll be looking at the first chapter of the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5. Sermon on the Mount has often been called the Christian Manifesto. It is certainly setting forth principles by which our Christian life should be lived. And so we encourage you to read it over, study it, meditate upon it. Let the Spirit of God just minister to your heart from Matthew 5. And then join with us tonight at 7 o'clock as we'll gather to worship the Lord. And we will be giving a commentary on the fifth chapter, an analysis, putting it together, and continuing our study through the Bible as we begin tonight the Sermon on the Mount. This morning we'd like to draw your attention to chapter 5, beginning with verse 46, as Jesus sums up this particular section of the Sermon on the Mount. This particular section began with a statement of Jesus to his disciples. And he said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter the kingdom of heaven. That must have been an extremely shocking statement to them, because everybody was familiar with the fact that the Pharisees lived for the sole intent of keeping the law. These fellows were the ones who dotted the I's and crossed the T's and were so circumspect about everything in the law. These were the men that Jesus said strained at a gnat. What did he mean by that? Well, under the law, it was not lawful to eat anything that had not been thoroughly bled. And if while you're walking down the street, a gnat should happen to fly in your mouth and you swallow it, you are violating the law because it wasn't thoroughly bled. So they would put their finger down their throat and gag and strain to get rid of that gnat in order that they might not violate the law. These were the ones who made sure that everybody knew how carefully they kept the law. These are the ones who would pray on the street corners so that men could see how righteous they were. They couldn't even wait to get to the temple to pray. They were so righteous they had to stop on the corners of the streets to pray. These are the ones who, when they gave, made a big to-do over it, hired a band to go in front of them as they brought their gifts unto the Lord. These were the ones that looked very dour and severe and stern so that people could know how righteous they really were. They had all the trappings, all the appearances. And when Jesus said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you're not going to enter the kingdom of heaven. It must have been a total shock to those rough fishermen and former tax collectors. My righteousness exceed theirs? And I'm certain that their first impression was, well, forget that. I can never do it. Now, at the end of this section, Jesus said to his disciples, for if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the sinners or the publicans the same? If you greet only your brothers, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, how does that strike you? When the Lord said, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. It strikes me as, I can't be perfect. I don't pretend to be perfect. I wish I were, but I'm not. But the question of Jesus that really strikes me is, what do you do more than others? Jesus had just told them that they were to love their enemies. They were to bless those that cursed them. They were to do good to those who hated them. And they were to pray for those who spitefully used them and persecuted them. And he said, if you don't, if you just love those that love you, then what do you do more than others? Sinners do that. If you only greet your friends, your brothers, what do you do more than others? Sinners do that. When Peter wrote his first epistle, taking from what Jesus had said here, no doubt, he was talking to the servants, and he said, you're to respect and reverence your masters, the evil ones as well as the good. And if you are guilty of a fault, and they buffet you or cuff you across the ear, and you take it patiently, so what? It doesn't really prove anything. But if you are innocent and they buffet you and you take it patiently, then he said, God is pleased. You see, as a Christian, you are not to have the normal responses that a worldly person has. You are to be different. God expects you to be different. We remember that when they were nailing Jesus to the cross, he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Peter said that Jesus actually gave us an example, who, when he was reviled, he reviled not again. An example of one who suffered wrongfully and yet really didn't rail against those who were persecuting him and crucifying him, but rather he prayed for them. Now, what Jesus is saying is that if I am truly a Christian, then it should be reflected in the attitudes that I have. I am to love my enemies. I am to do good to those who spite me and persecute me. And I'm not to have an attitude of resentment. I'm not to have a feeling, well, I'll get even with you if that's the last thing I ever do. But I'm to take these things with a pleasant attitude. A witness of Jesus is not something that you do, it is something that you are. It's demonstrated in your attitudes, which then will be reflected by your actions. And people are far more apt to be convinced of the truth of Christianity by the way you respond to adversity rather than by any apologetic that you may give to them for the Christian faith. But the moment I read of the right responses I'm to have, then I realize I can't do it. It's not in me to love my enemies. It is not in me to bless those that curse me. It's not in me to pray for those who spitefully use me and persecute me. And it is surely not in me to be perfect. The Christian life is impossible for me to live apart from the power of the Holy Spirit. And the minute I recognize that I can't do it myself, I need help, I will never be able to do it myself. In that recognition, I am on the path of discovery. The discovery of the grace and the mercy and the power of God, who is able to do for me what I can't do for myself. I'm taking the first steps of salvation in the recognition that I cannot live up to the requirements of God. Now, this had been the whole problem with the Pharisees. They were attempting to keep the law of God in their own power. And in so doing, they had to reinterpret the law. They changed it radically. And they interpreted the law as affecting and governing my outward actions, And they discarded the fact that the law was intended to check my inward attitudes from which the outward actions sprang. So in their minds, and Jesus gave the disciples five illustrations of this, in their minds, when the law said, thou shalt not murder, they felt very self-righteous. I've never clubbed anybody to death. I've kept the law. But Jesus said what the law really meant and was saying is that you're not to hate someone to the extent that you wish you could harm them. Nor are you to look down on someone as being worthless. Nor are you to think of a person as just a fool. For it is those attitudes, that lack of respect for others, that leads to murder. When the law said, thou shalt not commit adultery, because they had not gone to bed and had physical relations with someone other than their own spouse, they were feeling very smug. But Jesus said the law was intending to curb those desires that are in your heart. And if you look upon another woman other than your wife and you are lusting after her, then you are guilty. The attitude of your heart is wrong. And in each instant, as Jesus was giving the comparison with the way they had interpreted the law and the way God intended the law, you see how radically they had changed the law. But they had to do that in order to feel that sense of self-righteousness, like I have kept the law. But they were interpreting the law completely on a physical basis rather than on a spiritual basis. And in interpreting it physically, they might have kept it, but interpreting it spiritually, they were guilty, they were violators, and they needed God's help. But because they weren't conscious of their violation, because of their misinterpretation, they felt very self-righteous. They felt that they could look down on others. And Jesus manifested their attitude when he talked about how the Pharisee who went into the temple to pray said, oh God, I thank you I'm not like these other people. I pay my tithes and I do all of these things of the law, and I'm not like that sinner over there. Jesus said, that sinner over there, standing there in the temple, would not even as much as lift his head towards heaven, but just with bowed head smote on his chest and said, oh God, help me, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said, that fellow went away justified, whereas the Pharisee wasn't justified before God. But you see, when you interpret the law as something physical, and when you feel that you're really pretty good, that you've really done your part, and that you have made a strong effort, and you have really gone through the paces, then it gives you a sense of smugness, spiritual superiority, that of looking down on others. It gives you a sense of judging and condemning others. Intolerance for other people and their weaknesses. But the Lord wants us to have compassion. He wants us to be merciful. He wants us to be long-suffering. He wants us to be patient and kind in dealing with others. And it's when I realize that I have failed to keep the spiritual aspects of the law, that I am just as guilty as the next fellow, and that I don't have the capacity in myself to do it, that I have to depend completely upon the help of the Lord and the strength of the Lord, because it isn't in me to be perfect. It isn't in me to love my enemies. And I can only do that as He works in me by the Spirit and gives me the capacity by the Spirit, and realizing this is God's work of the Spirit. He has done for me what I can't do for myself. It gives me patience. It gives me understanding. It gives me mercy towards others who are struggling just as I have struggled to be what God would have us to be. Throughout this whole sermon, Jesus is showing that Christianity is really a matter of the heart, and that God is more interested in the attitude of your heart than He is the actions of your life. You may be doing the right thing, but you may have the wrong motive. Your actions may be right, but your attitudes are wrong. And the Lord is saying, it's the attitude that God is interested in. The attitude of your heart, the spirit. Someone has pointed out that the beginning of the sermon starts with the beatitudes, not the be-do-itudes. And they do deal with attitudes, the poor in spirit, the merciful. Dealing with the attitudes of a person's heart. The Pharisees have been putting the emphasis upon the actions, the doings, the physical aspects. But Jesus was redirecting the emphasis to the inner thought life, their spiritual state. And though they might look good on the outside, inside, He said, you stink. You're like whitewashed sepulchres that look very clean and whitewashed on the outside, but inside you're filled with dead men's bones, corrupting flesh. So the law was not given to make man righteous, nor to make man feel good about himself, or to make him feel spiritually superior, proud and pompous. But God intended the law to make us all feel guilty before God, so that I would be forced to come to Jesus Christ for mercy and grace, not for justice, not for rewards for my actions, but for forgiveness by His grace for my failures. The attitude of the Pharisees was despicable. They thought they were better than everybody else, and they were constantly condemning others and judging others. And Jesus was constantly using them as classic examples of what you shouldn't be. True Christianity is not manifested in a showy, outward pomp and circumstance and ornate garb. True Christianity is in the attitude of your heart before God. And because Christianity is a matter of the heart, the inward man, attitudes, conversion must be a spiritual experience. You must be born again of the Spirit of God if you're going to have an entrance into the kingdom of God and have a spiritual birth. True changes are not from the outside in, they are from the inside out. It is true that you cannot live up to the demands of Jesus. Your righteousness must exceed that of the scribes and the Pharisees. It can't be an outward showy righteousness. It must be a righteousness that has taken place within your heart and within your spirit through the work of the Holy Spirit in your life. And this is exactly the power that Jesus promised to his disciples when he said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be witnesses unto me. But you cannot be that apart from the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, Jesus is pointing out here that a Christian is vastly different from others. If suddenly being a Christian would be outlawed by the government, and you were arrested, would they be able to find enough evidence to convict you? Think about that. Are you different from others? On your workplace, does the difference show? Or do you just sort of blend in with the crowd? Are you being persecuted for righteousness' sake? There is a scripture that says, and they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Someone said, well, I've never been persecuted for being a Christian. Well, maybe you better look at yourself. For they who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Blessed are you, Jesus said, when men persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice, be exceeding glad, because they persecuted also the prophets that were before you. They who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution because you're different. And because you're different, you irritate the world that would like to bring you down to their level and cause you to blend with them. Now, the purpose for the standards being so high, higher than I am able to achieve or attain, is that I might be driven to come to Jesus Christ and just to rely upon him and his righteousness. I suddenly realize it's beyond my capacity. I can't do that. I can't fulfill those demands. Lord, I'm a sinner. It's not within me, within my capacity to do that. And so I come to Jesus as a sinner, confessing the fact that I can't do it, but in the same token, asking him to help me. The Lord, you see, wants you to depend upon him, not upon yourself, not upon your flesh. The scripture said that they that are in the flesh cannot please God. You just can't. The only way you can please God is by trusting. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Now, the purpose that God has in providing salvation by his grace through your faith in Jesus Christ is to eliminate all of your boasting. There's no place for me to glory in what I have done or in what I am doing. I can only boast in the fact that Jesus died for me. My redemption is bound up in Him. He paid the price. He did for me and does for me what I can't do for myself. And so I can only glory in Jesus. I can't tell you how wonderful I am. Of all the things I've accomplished, of all the things I've done, the sacrifices I've made, I can't tell you anything like that. All I can tell you is that I was a hopeless mess. I saw the ideal. I couldn't attain it. But Jesus did for me what I couldn't do for myself. And through the power of His Holy Spirit within me, I am what I am. But that's to Him the credit, the glory, the praise throughout eternity. To God be the glory, great things He has done. And as the hymn writer wrote, and when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, for Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left its crimson stain, but He washed it white as snow. And I'll only be able to praise the Lord and glory in Him throughout ages to come. The glory and praise be unto God, who by His grace and through His mercy forgave me my sin and came and indwelt my life and effected radical changes in my attitudes, in my thoughts, in the way I looked at things. Now, Paul the Apostle, after many years of walking with the Lord, said, I have not yet apprehended that for which I was apprehended, neither do I count myself perfect. Now the Lord said, be ye therefore perfect. But Paul, after 30 years, said, I don't yet count myself perfect. The Lord is still in the process of humbling me by showing me those areas of the flesh that still have a tendency to rise and to dominate over the spirit. It's interesting, the first thing I do when the Lord shows me some of the ugliness of my flesh, and I can see it, I say, oh Lord, that's horrible, that's terrible. I'll take care of that right away. And then I try. And I struggle. And I count 10. And I do everything I can. And it's still there. After all of my efforts. And I have to come back and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I just don't have the strength or the ability. I can't do that. And then I find that He steps in and He does it for me. Now, what does that do? That immediately eliminates any boasting of telling you how I conquered over temper, how I conquered over, you know, these things. I can't tell you that. All I can do is glory and say, you know, the Lord is so good. Where I was so weak and I couldn't do it, He came in and He did it for me. He's making the changes. He's transforming me into His image. He's doing for me what I can't do for myself. Oh, the Lord is so good. He is so merciful. He is so patient. He's been so patient with me. And He is bringing changes into my life. Change of my attitude. Change of my spirit. and he's conforming me into his image. He isn't finished, not by a long shot. I'm not yet what I should be, not by a long shot, but thank God I'm not what I was. I'm on the way, and the Lord is giving me the help that I need day by day. And one day, when he is through, I will be perfect, even as the Father in heaven is perfect. I will love my enemies. I will respond as he would have me to respond, in a loving response to negative experiences. Salvation is something that you can't do for yourself. One of the most frustrating things in all the world is to try to imitate Jesus Christ. It just can't be done. The church isn't something that you can join. You've got to be born into it. You've got to become a new creature in Christ Jesus. And it's through the total surrender of my life to Jesus Christ, allowing him then to live his life in me and through me. As the songwriter wrote, filled with his spirit, till all shall see Christ only always living in me. That's the ideal. As David said, and I shall be satisfied when I awake in his likeness. When he has accomplished his full purposes, I will be satisfied. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doesn't yet appear what we're going to be, but we know that when he appears, we're going to be like him. The process that I am in, as the Spirit of God is working in my life. Now, Paul, when he wrote to the Corinthians, said, examine yourself to see if you're in the faith and prove your own selves. And in another place, he said, for if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged of God. Look at yourself today and think of the question of Jesus, what do you do more than others? What are the distinctions about you that marks you as a Christian? In what way are you different from the world? What do you do more than others? And may the Lord, when we are so blinded by our prejudice of ourselves, and we think we're so great, may he put us to the test so that we can see the truth about us that he knows already. This week, as you respond and react to the things, the negative things that happen to you, if you respond and react just like any worldly person, then what do you do more than others? What difference is there between you and a non-Christian? If when you get cut off on the freeway, you lay on the horn and you shake your fist and you give an unpleasant sign, what do you do more than others? Even the heathen do that. Ask yourself. Jesus asked you. And when you realize those places of deficiency, then come and discover his all-sufficiency. Turn it over to him. Let him do for you what you can't do for yourself, that you might rejoice always in what he has done. Shall we pray? Father, we recognize that we have fallen short of that which we should be, that which we would be. And so we ask your help, Lord. May your Holy Spirit come and indwell our lives. And may we become everything you want us to be. Through the power of your Spirit working in us, transform our hearts, our attitudes. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we stand? David said, Lord, you've searched me and you know me. You know everything about me. You know more about me than I know about myself. And then he said, do search me, O God, and know my heart. And see if there be some way of wickedness in me. Lord, you search my heart. Show me, Lord, what you know about me. And may the Lord this week just, well, it's Thanksgiving, but it isn't very pretty when you see what's really inside. But may you see what's inside so that you'll come to him so he can work so you can be thankful. Thankful for what he's done, what he's doing, that which I can't do for myself. The Lord bless thee, Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
Now, on behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact the Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.